A quick experience report of how our journey on applying eXtreme programming practices on ETL projects. How many people here have worked on ETL projects, just so we get a sense of who's here? Okay. The rest of you, are you aware of ETL? What are the typical kind of challenges in ETL? And we're going to talk about some of the challenges that we faced in ETL and how we applied eXtreme programming practices to those things. Those are some pens, some gifts for people who are going to hang around till the end. Alright, I'm assuming most of you at some point have stayed in a hotel, right? Is a safe assumption to make? So when you walk into a hotel, they give you a price. This is the price of this room. They might have different categories of room and they might say these are the different prices for you. And do you ever wonder how do they quote these prices? From where do they get these prices? Is the person at the counter just arbitrarily looking at you and say, looks like a handsome guy, should be 7,000 rupees for you? Or do they have some standard rates defined and they just apply those standard rates across? Well, it actually turns out that IDEAS is a company which basically builds these analytic systems, which basically take a lot of data from different systems and then does a bunch of analytics on top of it, and then determines for different kinds of people who get into the hotel what the price should be for them. So in short, what we do at IDEAS is we do revenue optimization for the hotel industry. We also do revenue optimization for car parks. Big large airports have big car parks, and we do revenue optimization for car parks. And so that's kind of a quick gist about IDEAS. And the reason I talk about that is because it's important as we get into the nature of the problems we are solving to understand or appreciate what are the challenges we face. So if you look at a typical ETL process for us, there is a bunch of input data that is coming from different systems. You have various different hotels that are sending you data. You have third-party systems from where you're getting competitors' data. What are other hotels or what are other people selling their hotels at? You have a bunch of other third-party systems, like you have social media. We want to know what is the reputation of the hotel. Based on the reputation, we want to determine certain pricing decisions. So we have a bunch of downstream systems or input systems sending us data, which comes in different formats. Some send it as files, some send it as messages, some send it in different formats. And that basically goes into our ETL stage, which will basically normalize the data, will do aggregation, will do various other kinds of data cleanup. And then we'll take a copy and keep that, because you need to have data over a period of time to be able to apply our next stage, which is the IP or the analytics stage, where we would apply analytics on top of the data that we have got to be able to come up with these pricing decisions. At what price you should sell, how much overbooking can you take, what would be the cost of walking someone to a different hotel if everyone shows up and you've done overbooking and things like that. So some fairly complicated decisions are made, and those decisions need to be sent back to these systems, right? Because they need to know what the decision was and at what price they should sell or how much overbooking or things like that. Again, if you look at here at the bottom, there are different configurations or different parameters based on what you decide how much data to send. Do you need to send the entire decision? Do you need to only send the deltas? Do you need to send it for the entire year? Because someone's not just going to book the hotel for today. They might be booking for a hotel in the future date, right? So, those kind of decisions, whether you need to send a file, whether you need to send a message, whether you need to send some other format. So there's a lot of configurations, and based on that, you would send data back to these downstream systems or outbound systems, right? So that's in a nutshell, as simple as I can make it, what goes on in the system. So there is an analytics piece, and there is a ETL piece, which is basically going to crunch all the data that comes in, right? So that's a quick context. Right. Prafulla, do you want to talk about from a development point of view, right? How does it work?
Sorry. Yeah, sure. Let me know if you can't hear me. ETL, that's the word we hear in our organization many times. ETL process, we in the ETL process we talk with our known and unknown vendors. Sometimes known vendors they are difficult to deal with, and unknown vendors they are very easy to deal with. Our ETL process starts with a discovery, because we don't know what data we are going to get. The discovery phase is a very important phase in our life, because we need to know what we are going to deal with. The concept is formed. What is the concept? I want to use my social media data to make or to refine my hook, my output, or my decisions to the hotel. That's the thing. Like, how does that come to us? There is an innovation council that gets set, and they suggest, oh, you should be doing this. There is a market research that tells us we should be doing this. There are vendors who come to us and say, please, can we do business together? There is our own team. They tell, like, we need to go and look for this data. That will improve our ETL. So that concept, after a long brainstorming, we decide that we need to do such and such ETL process. The next thing happens, we start with the data exploration. Who are the players in the market who could provide us data? First of all, we have just the high level information. Oh, I want social media data. Apart from that, I don't know what exactly I would be getting. Then we find out those players who can help us in finding out that data. And we start interacting with them, and we come up with a set of data. We tell them, please don't bother yourself when it comes to sending data to us. Just give whatever you have to us, we will take care of it. So what we get here is the unstructured data. And at the same moment, we get our research team together and give this data to them. Research teams analyze the data, and they come up with some idea as to how this data could be used in practice. And once that decision is arrived, then there are certain teams, special teams, they come to be and they start structuring the data. I'm getting thousands of fields or hundreds of fields which are not really useful. Analytics says, oh, we need just only 15, 20, 30, 40, 50 columns. We don't need more. So we just constrain that data, unstructured data, and we come up with something what ideas needs. And this is then put into a requirement form, a specification document for outward vendors, we would say. And they go through all these documents and they start working on it. So this is the phase where we just transform our unstructured data into structured data with the help of course, the analytics team members. The general process would look like this. The flow would look like this. Concept, form concept, get the data, explore it, structure it, then give it your requirements to ETL developer. And we also formalize our communication interface, because that's more important for us. And once that is done, then the two teams depart with weekly handshake or a fortnightly handshake. And then IDS team starts looking at internal customers, their way of communication, the requirement for each of them. And the software is formed, and then it is delivered as per the specification and
So let's talk about some of the difficult challenges that we face when we try to accomplish this, right? So we've kind of given you a very brief about the context in which we operate, what is the general workflow or life cycle of how products get built, right? So when you take something like this, what are the typical challenges that you will see? The first and the foremost challenge that you will see very clearly is a lot of teams are involved in this, a lot of handovers, a lot of handshakes, and that leads to a lot of people working in silos. The next thing you will see is people start focusing on what they need to do, and the awareness about the big picture, about how, you know, let's say you're getting some reputation data over here and how that's going to influence some of your decisions, that entire big picture might be lost. You know, people work in silos and people focus on their piece of stuff. That obviously leads to last minute surprises, right? People end up with having some kind of surprises. We have external parties, we have internal teams, we have a lot of moving parts into the system. That obviously causes late delivery, no surprise over there, because you end end up doing rework, you end up doing a lot of rounds of negotiation. And if you look at our overall time to market, right, these days time to market is extremely critical. Everyone wants to squeeze the time to market as little as possible. But the nature of the beast that we are dealing with is where you end up basically spending a large amount of time in the discovery because you don't know how this data can be used. This is not building a website, right? I mean, you're trying to figure out there is some complex data, simplifying that down, then taking it into your system. So a lot of time spent in the discovery. And by the time you say, ah, that data actually can be transformed and it can be used this way, you have very little time left for actually doing the development. Does that sound familiar? Yeah.
So when you say there's very little time for doing development, what development?
That I don't understand. What development? So what we have done in the discovery process is we've basically taken the data, we've run through various different algorithms in the analytics side, and we figured out that yes, this will influence, right? But we need to work at a much larger scale now because that data will come consistently. You need to automate a whole bunch of things because it was all done manually to start with.
So automating that in scripts or something.
Automating a lot of different things, building more resilient code because you just took data, you got it to see work, okay, this is useful. Now you need to automate the entire process, right? You need to make this scalable, consistent, all of that stuff. So that's where a lot of time goes in development and development gets squeezed as usual. What would that lead to? Right? Everyone's happy? No, of course, because you know everyone squeezed for time, so there is a lot of finger pointing, saying, "Oh, only if you guys could have discussed that and formalized that, you know, interface earlier, we wouldn't have to deal with all of this stuff." And a lot of times, unfortunately, scaling becomes a bottleneck because we are so focused on getting this to work, but we don't think at what scale we'll be operating, how many integrations we will be doing, what is the amount of data that will be coming in, and the system that we are building. Can they actually scale seamlessly? So some of those challenges you will see. And actually, Prafulla, why don't you talk about some of the vendor-related challenges, because that's a big part of how we operate.
Right, so far we have seen how ideas itself is affecting the development or the delivery. But there's another player that we have seen, the small little box, which say vendor. And vendor is equally important because if vendor doesn't send data to us, we are not going to right or refine stuff or values or decisions to our customers. So we also take care of our vendor. We also work with vendor very closely. The most important problem that we face with the vendor is the requirement conformity. Vendor A says, oh, I can meet your requirement very easily. Vendor B says, oh, we don't maintain this data. Vendor C says, we cannot give this data because there are some legal bindings on us. We cannot do this. And then you start juggling. That adds to a lot of discussion, signing contracts, so many things, and then you get first glimpse of that data. And what if that third vendor C has the largest client list? Then our time to market is still lengthy. Next thing is requirement misunderstanding. We always meet over the phone. We don't know the vendor is in Singapore, Tokyo, LA, or they have a person working from LA, they have a person sitting in Chicago, and few members, development team members in Singapore. Lot of different combinations we see. So for them also, what ideas want, they don't know at times. And first thing, when we have first meeting, we share specification, they all say, yeah, we understood everything, yeah, it's well and good. When they start working actually on it, they come back. What did you say that day? Oh, we can't do this. Oh, that's not possible. So that sort of discussions happen a lot, and we take care of it now by our experience. They develop everything, they give it to us. They say, hey, ideas, take this, integrate with us, make this call to API, we'll get everything. And now, they don't know that when for a forecast, good forecast is forecasting system, you need data from past. And now we say, we need data from past for 2 years. And then API starts misbehaving. And we are again in a problem. We take care of those problems nowadays very well. Late change of data. All these bottom three, they contribute to the late change in data. Their legal binding, they also, all the things that matter to us. Delays are part of our system because we work with vendor with different vendors. So just to give you an example, like for portals, when we get portals data, we have 45 vendors. For social media, we have 4 vendors. And all of them, and competitors, we have 10 to 15 vendors. So they all have their own way of working. They have their own lingos, their terms about the business, they are different from ideas. And it takes a lot of time for us to match the expectation itself. And priorities, of course, if ideas business is not priority, who will work with ideas? No, any idea? That whole thing comes there. And we, after 10, 12 years of experience, we manage them better. So that's about the vendor. But we'll take a break here. Let me introduce Naresh. I think there's no one here who doesn't know Naresh. Naresh runs the LFAQ. He's a great coach and he's a great orator. You can contact him over here.
Yeah, that's interesting. So I started working with ideas about a year now ago, and Prafulla leads the integration development teams at ideas. How many years have you been there again? I think much older than how I am, right?
15 years.
He's been at ideas 15 years doing ETL, doing integration. So he's obviously the subject matter expert, and we thought it would be good to share our experience of how we're going through this journey. So that's why we are kind of working together on this presentation.
Yeah, so this is not a technical story. This is a story of efforts made by those small little teams coming together to get ideas to a level where we don't have to face some of the problems that we discussed. Everyone has contributed this success to the success, and we are going to walk you through how we are going to tell this story. We started on practicing Agile in 2010, and that's the time we got integrated with many systems or aspects of XP or Agile. So we started our projects from 2010, and in the last 4 years, we completed some of these integrations. The scale of these integrations, I want to first mention, this one is almost 6,000 portals. This is nearly 3,000 portals, and this is around 700 portals. So that's the scale that we are working. And we are also learning many things over this, or we have learned many things over these 4 years through these projects. So we are going to walk you through all these stages in the next 20 minutes.
I'm sure everyone's familiar with this. This is what we were doing considering the nature of the beast, and we wanted to move to something that's more iterative, incremental, and at least felt to well. ETL projects, integration projects, can also benefit from some of these, but you know, not many people actually talk about this. This is not very common. I mean, a lot of people that we know still continue to operate in the previous style. So we were not even sure if some of these practices can actually be very successfully used. So we said, well, let's give it a try. And we started with the first project that came along. So we said, can we use some of the XP practices here? Let's see if this can help. So I'm going to quickly run through a couple of practices, right? The whole team approach, breaking the entire iteration into the entire release into smaller iterations so we can have something early, demoable, and we can try and see how we are progressing. We felt CI was a very important, integral part of making this journey. So we said, let's get continuous integration going and let's set it up. We didn't even have the right tools when we started, but we said, well, let's give it a shot. We'll talk later about some of the tools that we had to deal with. And we said, let's start with some user stories. Let's not write these big requirement documents that, you know, no one really reads. So let's start with, you know, breaking that down into user stories. And it's not more of a requirement document, but let's try and put it in terms of what is that, you know, what is the problem that we are trying to solve from a user's perspective, right? These were, I think, the four key practices that we started with. We didn't want to be too ambitious. We didn't want to say, oh, let's put everything and let's see how it goes. We started with these four practices and we said, let's see how that shapes up. And the entire project was actually delivered. We had some challenges, but I think these practices help. And because these practices help, when we got the next integration project, we said, well, we learned some things from that. Can we build on top of that? Can we evolve those things? And can we add a few more practices? So when we got the next integration project, we basically started with pair programming because we felt that was one of the key things that was missing in our previous project. So we started with pair programming. We'll talk a little later about some of the challenges we ran into. We wanted people to do a little bit better homework and come more prepared to the planning meetings, to the grooming meetings, instead of just showing up and then, you know, wasting everyone's time. So there was a little bit of more focus on basically being more prepared towards the planning. We introduced test-driven development. We felt that this is important and this needs to go in for our CI to be actually successful. By this time, we had noticed that a lot of code that was written felt like that spaghetti code, right? So we said refactoring is an integral part and we need to introduce these practices. We have architects in the US who had set some coding standards and we talked about that and the team got together and they looked at those coding standards. We still debate about them, but it was a good starting point. We said at least let's start thinking about coding standards so that it looks like it's one team producing it, not a hodgepodge of stuff, right? There was a lot of focus on teamwork, team ownership, right? You know, we used to work very individualistically, especially when it comes to, you know, some of the challenges we talked earlier, silos and all of that stuff. There was a lack of collective ownership. So we said, you know, collective ownership is important. One of the classic things you will see with ETL or integration projects is that people go big bang to try and look at every possible thing that could go wrong. If you're getting 500 fields in a feed, how can we store all these 500 fields? How do we model it, even if you're only going to be using four fields, right? So we go overboard, we kind of complicate things. So we said, well, let's simplify things. Let's focus on simple design. Very common in the ETL space is to worry about optimization even before you've written a single line of code, right? You don't even have a system working, but you start talking about what happens if you get a million records and how would you scale this, how would you optimize this? So we said, well, let's get it to work first and then we will optimize, right? So that was, again, easier said than done, frankly. Whenever we got a bug, we said, let's do test-driven development on it. So we will write a test to prove that the bug exists and then we will do the development. So these were a few practices that we put in place for this project. Was this easy?
Yeah, damn easy.
Just walk in and tell the team here, these are the practices and everyone knows exactly what you mean by any one of those, right? It was hard. What we are trying to talk here is that these are not easy. This is a journey over 4 years, right? We're trying to squeeze it into a 45-minute presentation. But over 4 years, there's been blood and sweat spilled over some of these things.
And tears too.
And tears, of course. But let's talk about, okay, we got here, some of these practices. Are we doing it as per the industry standard? Are we like perfect? No, far away from that. But we got started, right? That's the important thing. We got started. Some of the teams started accepting it. There's still a bunch of skeptics, and that's always going to be there. But at least a few people bought into the idea. A few people said, yes, this makes sense, and this is actually applicable to ETL projects. Because the first thing you talk about this is, that applies for website development. We are different. Doesn't apply for us, right? So even to get people to accept some of these is good. Let's talk about how we evolved from here further, right? The last integration that we did. Let's talk about some of those things because we kind of went interesting in some of those.
Right. So far we have seen two integrations that we did. Let's start purely written in SAS, right? SAS is our current company and we selected their programming language for our ETL process. Second one was written in completely in Java. So, SAS, when we accepted it as a programming language, we were quite new to it. I would say none of us were even knowing what SAS, what the language or the code over there looked like. everyone was skeptical, but we were trying to for the kind of a business decisions that we got into, and we had to do it in SaaS. We started working in SaaS, and you see the strategy over there, right, earlier, and we wrote it more exactly like that. We didn't know how SaaS is, what are the do's and don'ts of SaaS programming. We never looked at it, but we started just marching towards the goal, right? And that's why we got into a space, I will show you a little later. And when Oprah came by, we said, oh, let's do it in Java. It's far better. We wrote it in Java. Java is very agile-friendly language. And we got all those items covered in our Opera development. There's a side story to this Pegasus. When this came, all of us, we rose and said, we want to do this in Java. Business guy came back and said, do you know one thing? If you do this project in SaaS, you are going to reuse 50% of the code from Hillstar. I don't want to get into that angle. I want delivery to be done. Oh, we said, no. Java is the most friendly language. We want to do everything over there. And we will do it. He said, yes, fine. Next meeting he came back, he said, okay, you guys say it's Java. I want everything done in 2 months. The development that took years was asked to be done in months, and we were surprised. So when we had such talks and such business pressures were there, and we had 3 options. First thing, reward and say Java. Second thing, bend on me and go and do, get the Hillstar code, chop wherever it is possible, insert your plugs over there and make it happen. And third thing, yes. Okay, let's trace it. Who says SAS is not agile-friendly language? Everyone stood up. Then we said, we want to make it agile-friendly language. And let's try it. And in that way, we took that challenge. And business was also happy because we are now going to do or going to reuse the code that they were asking for. So we started there. But before that, let's look at why SaaS is so. Why people are afraid of SaaS? Because SaaS is not generally available outside. That was the case then. First thing was, I introduced SaaS here a little bit. SaaS is a very powerful data management engine. It contains macros, functions, and procedures that help you manage your data very effectively. I have run some tests. It churns 15,000 rows, 100,000 rows in few milliseconds. It doesn't take time. And it's very data-friendly language. When I was working with Naresh and Kaval, when we discussed it, we found that this is some of the features are very close to functional programming. Right? Functional programming is a buzzword nowadays, right? So everyone is trying to learn some functional programming language. So SAS is very close to it. And now, when I was speaking with one of our colleagues from SAS, today itself, he invited me with this. SAS, you can learn SAS on the web now. This is the link that he gave to me. I just included in this session. So SAS is not really a big problem here. The code that we wrote in Kettle was a spaghetti code. Right? Long functions, 500 lines, 1000 lines, you don't know what is there. Another thing in SAS is it's a lexical scoping. So that was another problem to us. So we started looking at the problems that SAS posed to us. We couldn't get unit tests in. We couldn't fail or fail when SAS code failed. We couldn't understand what SAS was doing as a programming language. And we started working on these problems.
I mean, it's also a platform more than a language, so right. There's a lot more to learn about the entire platform than just the language. So there were a lot of things that people were afraid of. They didn't want to go because it's an unknown territory. Right,
SAS is a very good analytic engine. It has a very good ETL engine, and it has very good BI engine or visual analytics. And there are various other products that SAS comes up with. So we started focusing on unawareness. We got our friends enhanced for unit testing, the testability. And by doing so, we came up with a tool that was, it's a SAS unit. It's a Jain transformation of SAS, for SAS. So we explored that tool and we found that we could integrate it with many other systems. After adopting that tool, some of our functions, they become like this. Very small, manageable, testable, right? Measurable, everything was there. So we adopted the tool. First thing we made is we made it part of our local build and we made it fail fast. Second thing we did is we took it to the Jenkins. And in Jenkins, we also made it fail fast. And now the difference in Jenkins is that we published all the failure reports to the outside world. So the crux is, like, when there are engineering practices, they are always at the core. You pick any language, they have to be at the core. The tools may not be there, but when you have a commitment, you can always make it happen. So there are some benefits that we got. I think Naresh, you have a better insight into it.
I think we have 10 minutes, we will have to blaze through this, so we can talk about challenges. And I think that's what is more interesting, is what are the challenges we ran into and how we came about. So, quickly kind of running through, internal code quality went up, because as you could see, smaller functions, more unit testing, other kinds of practices put in place, CI. External quality went up, so perceived number of reports from the clients in terms of things not matching their expectation. We could see a noticeable difference in that, right? That went down. Refactoring was always looked as, you know, you did a shabby job and you know you have to now spend additional time refactoring stuff. But now people changed their attitude. They said, you know what, refactoring is a very integral part of how we do development. It's not something that it's a mistake and now I am, you know, rectifying it. It's more about this is how design evolves and this is part of that. There was a lot of focus on keeping code clean. I mean, now we would, in the planning meeting, people would be talking about why this is important and there would be discussions around clean code. Earlier, we had to push for that. We had to ask, whether are you duplicating the code? How are you going to do this? And now people are like, no, I need some time to basically do that in a clean way. So I think we saw that. And the most important thing, in my opinion, is that the time to market. Right. The time to market, if you look at these three products that we evolved, we could see clearly a noticeable difference in the amount of time to market. Why does that happen? Why did the time to market reduce? If you look at some of the challenges that we talked about earlier, late discovery and problems like that, we could find some of those things much earlier. We were able to integrate with the vendors much more often. We were able to work with them much more closely because some of these things. So I think that really helped us. This is, people were dreaming about unit tests all the time. It became such an integral part about, how you do things. When you ask someone for, this is the feature, they will be thinking about, okay, what are the unit tests that can write? And I think that's a very important shift that we could see. This is how the team felt now, right? Earlier it was like all the silos, everyone working in their silos, don't bother me, give me the spec, I will work with that. Now this is how the team felt. So I think there was some really good stuff. But nothing comes for free, right? All of these things don't just happen. Why don't, Prafulla, you talk about some of the change management challenges that we faced?
Yeah, so nothing comes free, there are no free lunches. So when we started, everyone had this feeling about agile practices. They had their own definitions. They were looking for some prescribed steps every time because we are quite used to now waterfall. I heard two lightning discussions in the lightning session. They were all around this. But it's not really the state, prescribed state that you look for. But there is something which more than this which we learned. The incremental design or incremental and iterative design?
Yeah, I mean, what we were doing earlier was more of just incremental design. It had to be perfect the first time that you're done with it, right? The notion of you can do the just enough and just, do a simple thing, or what people call about as
mile wide, inch deep. Right? Go mile wide, inch deep. Earlier it was like, let's get this one thing fully fleshed out before we look at something else. And this change of this attitude was very important. And I think the practice of story mapping really helped us over there, where we get everyone together and we'd say, okay, if you're talking about reputation data and how that's going to influence your decision, let's talk about the entire thing. What is the outcome? Most people were surprised. I mean, I don't know. I'm just going to take this data and give it. I don't know what happens next. Why do I care about it? I said, no. You need to know how someone's going to consume the data for you to be able to, as simple as for you to be able to do effective design of your databases, right? Because is it going to be read? Is it going to be read more often? Is it going to be, written more often? How do you optimize things? So a lot of those discussions happened because of that. The whole concept of creating spikes, right? The field in which we are, there's a lot of ambiguity, right? It's not like a website where this is 10 steps, you just need to repeat that over and over again. You're integrating with a new vendor. They have some technology that you're not aware of. They're going to expose certain ways of how we will consume the data. And a lot of times this is ambiguity. So what would we typically do? Sit and analyze. We would analyze. And say, oh, I don't know that data, I don't know what to do, so let's do some more analysis. And we try to change that mentality. We say, yes, we don't know, but can we take a fixed time box and maybe 2 days, and why don't you try and just write some basic stuff to see how you can consume that data, how you can get the data, how you can send it downstream. So the whole practice of basically doing your spikes was very important. Helping people change that was very hard. CI, taking the ownership, so even though we put CI, then we would see that there were failed builds a lot of times, and no one would care. Let's fill, whatever, we'll fix it later, somebody else's problem, not my problem. So getting people to take the ownership that, you can't leave the build broken, it's collective ownership. That took a lot of time to go through.
Yeah, we're still working on it.
Pairing itself, I think, why do I need to pair? I can just do it myself. Why do I need to pair? Pairing was a hard practice again to get people to get to understand. And it was not just about developers pairing with developers. It was about cross-functional pairing. It's about pairing with other people because we have very short time to market, a lot of ambiguity. So how do you get people to work closely together so that in the given time you can deliver stuff? I mean, team ownership was this is the classic story with team ownership. I think we still have some challenges with team ownership, but I think it's way better than what it was before. If you look at testers not being part of design decisions, a lot of times testers were not involved as part of the design decisions. The general conception was like, what value do they add to design? So actually what, depending on how you're designing things, they would be able to tell you, they would be able to mistake-proof your design. But that was very hard to convince people that actually testers can add value. And a lot of times, bringing them in, running a small experiment to see if they can actually add value was very important. A lot of testers were also not used to doing automated testing and things like that. So that was another thing we'll talk about. 5 minutes to go, yes. How do testers get measured in most organizations? Based on the number of bugs they face, right? And the general notion is a tester is performing well if they're putting in more bugs, right? So we wanted to change that attitude. We wanted to change the attitude saying your job is not to find bugs. Your job is to stop the bugs from getting in the first place, right? Mistake proofing is important rather than finding defects and inspection. And again, a lot of automation practices put in place, things like that. So again, each of these things that I'm talking about might sound very easy, but we had a lot of challenges, pushback, helping people to understand why these are important. And we're still by no means done. I mean, we still have a lot of things to go. Every time a new member comes in, we have to go through the same cycle again with the new member. So we have some of those challenges. We have last 5 minutes left, so Prafulla, can you talk about road ahead for us?
Yeah, I'll quickly go through what we are still want to continue with. Core refactoring practices, we want to make more headway. Right now, team has started just thinking about it. Now, it should be now integral part of like unit test should be integral part of the story itself, story development itself. Simple design, think, don't think complex. Take step by approach. Design and evolve your design. We'll see it later. Try sandbox. Don't solve all the problems in your context. Take the problem out of the context, solve it, and bring it back to, bring that solution back to the context. And by doing this, you are going to try the evolutionary design. Right? Other thing that we want to try is the programming skills and polyglot. Our developers should know different languages so that they understand the features provided in those languages and try to imitate them in some of in Java that we use right now. On the business front, we want to go ahead with real-time integration. And our teams are working on it at this moment. Real-time versus scheduled or batch, that is the battle that we are now solving. We are going real-time. There are many vendors which will be supporting this. We are going with them real-time. For others, we may stay scheduled this. The other thing that we must or we should try, I would say, is the joint application development with vendors. We've seen that slide where we had a lot of conflicts or a lot of issues there. We can solve those issues when we sit together, not over the phone, but sit together and talk about the requirements. The major takeaways from this for us are engineering practices are universal. With determination and perseverance, you can always get there. It is very easy to deviate from standard. So we have to be very determined. The XP practices delayed us to creating a T-shaped individuals or generalized developers. Many of us are now thinking in that way. They are not there, but now they are opening up to this idea. And product discovery and story mapping, they are vitally important for our alignment. Alignment with vendors, alignment within our teams. So that's what we think. And so our session ends over here, but our efforts and ideas will continue. Do you have any questions?
Yep, we have 1 or 2 minutes, so we could certainly take a couple of questions. Yes, please.
Spike, or can we consider it as one of the user story in a current sprint? Because it may not align to any of the actual feature or user story that I'm working on. Could be something else. So, what is the best way of considering the refactoring it?
Okay, so I'll just rephrase your questions, or I'll just repeat so I've at least understood it correctly. I think your question is that when you have refactoring, should you take it as a technical spike or should you take it as a user story, right? I would kind of step back and say, why are you refactoring the code, right? I'm assuming you're refactoring the code because you see that you're going to be adding some new functionality or you're fixing a bug and this, you know, unfactored code is getting in your way. So I would try and see if that could be made part of that, right? Sometimes it could be so widely spread that, you know, putting it as part of some other story might be difficult. And in those cases, at least I would make that one fix for the time being and maybe add it as a technical debt story later to be, you know, dealt with. So it doesn't matter so much in my honest opinion whether you treat it as a technical spike or you treat it as another story. The point is you need to do one in the context of what you're working, at least get one thing fixed, and then maybe you understand what effort it would take to do the rest of them, and that could be a separate task or a separate story.
Okay. Just one more question.
Yeah, go ahead.
I'll be loud. So what kind of tools and technologies that you have explored to automate the ETL jobs, if at all they use like open source or license tools? So that would be one question. And second is, what kind of challenges you face when to change a traditional QA role to a modern agile testing team? So those two questions.
Second one is easy. We are doing a talk tomorrow where we're going to talk about that very thing. So if you're interested, we're going to do, Sachin and I are going to do another talk tomorrow where we're going to talk about the QA transformation, right?
Especially on the ETL side, other product, web application development team
Correct. That's the focus of our talk tomorrow. So that one we will handle tomorrow. Let's come to the first one, which is the tools we have explored, which in our case is pretty standard.
Yeah, we have very standard stacks, JQuery technologies. We are using JBoss. Pretty much open source. There isn't any like paid apart from SQL Server or so.
Any kind of frameworks that
are. So we are playing around with Storm right now. And we're basically doing some experiments on it. But otherwise, traditionally, a lot of stuff was written in Java J2EE, and SAS was a big component as well. So there was a lot of ETL work that was done in SAS. So between Java J2EE and SAS was predominantly the tech stack. But one of the things we see is that we kind of, for every integration, repeating the same plumbing work over and over again. So we're exploring frameworks like Storm and others to see, you know, if we can basically offload all the plumbing work to the framework and we can focus on the business logic.
And in another product, our team of architects, they are exploring various combinations at this moment, because there is no straight answer in the market available for our problems. And at times you need to you get into a lot of pain when you absorb that new, basically code from the market. So they are exploring newer ways to do this real-time integration and other aspects of our ETL.
Okay.
All right, last question, because we need to run for the keynote.
I would have a question. I would like to share something. Right?
Yeah, please.
So, I found the good point that where to introduce, at what stage we should introduce those testers in the project. Right, that is a good thing. Actually, the ideas they are involving testers in the designing phase. Really, this is a good thing. I just wanted to share that actually we are involving testers right from the analysis of the requirements. Yeah, definitely they are contribute better with us. It is a joint venture for us.
Yeah. Absolutely, yeah. So if you see where we talk about the story mapping, so actually testers are an integral part of the story mapping session.
Right.
And then we get into design discussions post that, then we also want to involve the testers. So a lot of places, testers are involved in the requirements and things like that, but they stop there and then they go in a different direction.
Right.
We are saying, no, let's keep them as an integral part throughout.
Yes, actually we are doing that. Actually, we are defining, the developers are defining a unit test, and that will be shared along with the testers. And then tester will contribute the additional test cases with that, and that will complete the unit testing for them.
Yeah, yeah. We actually are doing a lot of pairing, so developers and testers are sitting together and actually working. Right, so that is again speeding up things for us. Cool.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you, guys. I know there are more questions, but we do need to open the rooms for the keynote, so we'll kind of jump back. Thank you.